I'll be moderating today's discussion. I'd like to welcome all of our audience, our Master of Architecture students, our SUTD community. I'd like to welcome the architecture community here today, and any other students from other universities, polys, welcome. If you'll forgive me, a quick moment to let you know a little bit about SUTD and our program here at ASD. So the Master of Architecture lecture series reinforces the centrality of sustainability to our curriculum. It positions our Master of Architecture students at the forefront of discourse on sustainable progressive architecture. Our pillar, Architecture and Sustainable Design, has been committed to sustainability for the past 12 years. And our students and faculty have achieved international distinction in this area. In this slide, you'll see a project by Professor Carlos Bañón. This is the Air Mesh Pavilion. Carlos won the President's Design Award for 2020 for this. It is one of the world's first 3D printed space frame structures. We also have the world's tallest 3D printed biomaterial tower by Professor Stylianos Dritsas, and also some wonderful images of conservation work by our UNESCO awarded Professor Yo Kang Shua, whose work includes our historic Chinese pavilions here at SUTD that I hope you'll have a chance to visit. So the MARC lecture series permits us to invite distinguished architects, planners, and designers who have made significant contributions to share their work and speak with our students. This year's theme, Design Beyond Zero, references the Singapore Green Plan for 2030. And we're asking how designers can leverage this push for carbon neutrality to also maximize vibrancy, productivity, and livability for our built environment, for our cities. This lecture should foster interaction with our audience and our students. At the end of the presentation, we'll invite you to ask your questions. Students in particular, please don't be shy. By way of introduction, I hope I don't go on too long. We're very, very honored to welcome a distinguished guest today, Dr. Liu Tai Ker, the founder and chairman of Morrow Architects and Planners. Dr. Liu is known throughout the world as the father of urban planning in Singapore, due in no small part to his 23 years of significant contributions in Singapore as a civil servant. The contributions are many. I hope you'll forgive me for reading from my notes. From 1969 to 1989, Dr. Liu served as the chief architect and later CEO in the Housing and Development Board. During his tenure, he was involved in the planning, design, and implementation of public housing in Singapore and was instrumental in delivering the Singapore government's home ownership for all policy. Dr. Liu was involved in the planning and design of 20 satellite new towns with a population size of about 200,000 each. He and his team oversaw the construction and management of about 500,000 housing units, including their supporting facilities and amenities. These new towns not only provided high-quality homes, but also created functionally and highly self-sufficient communities. From 1989 to 1992, Dr. Liu served as the chief planner and CEO of the Urban Redevelopment Authority, where he led the planning of Singapore's 1991 concept plan. The plan was recognized at home and throughout the world as a set of forward-looking and practical development blueprints. With planning strategies that would guide Singapore towards becoming a modern city of excellence. After leaving civil service, Dr. Liu joined RSP, Architects and Planners, as senior director. And in 2017, he founded Morrow Architects and Planners, where he serves today as the chairman. With his many years of planning and architecture experience, we're really very grateful for Dr. Liu to share his pragmatic and well-tested insights with the world, with our young planners and architects here at SUTD. On a personal note, when I was writing my PhD, I had the chance to read Dr. Liu's essay, 1975 essay, Design for Better Living Conditions. This was a real revelation for me. My topic was on how designers use data to lead the creation of better cities. And Dr. Liu's clear, unapologetic essay, providing a pragmatic method of leveraging data to push for functional livable design, was a true inspiration for a full chapter in my PhD. So I still assign this reading to my students when I teach housing, actually. So I'm thrilled to learn that the title for today's speech is Intelligent Planning, Singapore Experience. I'm personally fascinated, and I'm sure it will be of great value to our students. Dr. Liu, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today. I invite you now to take over and share your work with us.
Hello. Okay. Thank you, Peter. Okay, today I'm talking about intelligent planning because I feel that there's a misunderstanding that planning is about, producing an urban plan is about drawing pretty colorful pictures. It's not. Actually, behind the colorful plan, urban plan, there's a lot of thinking, a lot of hard work behind it. So I use the word intelligent. We have to use our brain to think through every issue before we talk about planning. So, and I want, actually my key message today is that don't treat planning as an exercise in producing sexy looking drawings. It's really putting a lot of hard work behind it. So let me just carry on. I've been introduced already, so Chairman Morrow, and the reason I use Morrow is because that was the name used by my father for his art studio in the 50s. So I thought I'll just use it. And despite the short history, I also have a small office in Shanghai because a lot of my work take place in China. That's my past. Okay, HDB, URA, RHP, Center for Livable City, I was the chairman for 12 years, and also SCE, I was there for about 5 years. A lot of people think of me just as a planner. Actually, this is not to show you how many awards I get, it's just to show you. Actually, my first love is architecture because you get more satisfaction to see the result of your work. To be a planner, if you can see 15% of the result of your work, you're lucky. But I continue to do planning because planning benefits a lot more people, so I continue to do that. But for personal satisfaction, architecture gives me more satisfaction. So these are the topics I'm going to talk to you this afternoon. Let me start with transformation of Singapore. I'm going to talk to you about old Singapore, new Singapore indicators, because most of you in the audience today were not around in 1960s. Many of you may not even be around in 1985. So let me take you back to our short history, only 57 years. In 1960, Singapore was dilapidated, poor, backward. We were more backward than Yangon, Manila, and Ho Chi Minh City. We were definitely one of the most backward cities in the world and in Asia. But just in case young people like you don't trust an old man like me, with my own words, just to prove it to you, in 1960, when the British pulled out of Singapore, 3 out of 4 people lived in this condition. One of my regrets nowadays is I did not think of preserving a few hectares of this kind of properties to show younger Singaporeans how far we have moved forward. But that was the Singapore I knew as a kid. And even as recent as 1970, this is our Shenton Way. It's just full of slum area. And we look at Singapore River, just cluttered with boats and so on. But fast forward, in 25 years, Singapore became a world-class city, 25 years. Livable, prosperous, progressive. To do so, I think this we have to thank to our first-generation political leaders. They wanted us to protect nature, particularly the reservoirs and so on, but as well as the forests. And also, I had an opportunity to also convince the government to respect our heritage, historical buildings. And after, whenever I had a chance to do a plan, I would do the protection first before I talk about new development. Okay, because protecting nature and heritage is something that cannot be recreated. So if there's something valuable, we must protect first before we talk about new development. So what do we protect? Like this is Bukit Timah Nature Reserve. It's only a secondary jungle, but an English expert came here many years ago, and after testing, I realized that in this 1 square kilometer of land, we had more biodiversity than the whole of Northern America because we're in a tropical area. In fact, this jungle in Bukit Timah was officially declared protection by me, and I actually pushed the boundary slightly bigger to protect the whole hill, because the original boundary did not cover the whole hill. Okay. And in further, you see, we're not talking about just land in Singapore, because from the very beginning, from 1960, when we were so desperate poor, our government already decided that we must control pollution. And we have to thank our political leaders for that, because our seawater is very relatively clean or highly clean, and therefore the underwater world is still very alive, although it's being affected now by the temperature. And heritage, whatever you see here, this picture, in Singapore we have protected 25 times this area, Singapore. Given our short history, this is quite a major achievement. And so after protecting and so on, the new development, you can see, compare this with the kampong you saw earlier, there's a big change. Okay, this is a Bishan. And even the CBD you saw just now, it was a slum area. Within about 15 years, the change was totally dramatic. And so our change was not only in terms of quality, but also quantity. And that requires very good government support as well as intelligent planning. That's why I emphasize intelligent planning, not producing sexy looking drawings, is to put a lot of thoughts behind it. And here I want to emphasize that we're rather unique in the world that next to the extremely tall tower, we still protect our historical area, like those buildings with the red roofs. Okay. And in other countries, they would like to have the new building surrounding the historical district to have high control and gradually rising. But we can't afford that because we don't have the land. But when a lot of European friends come to see Singapore and saw this, they said, wow, this is really a very unique feature of Singapore. So it turned out to be something people are impressed. And so those are the pictures, but I think younger people believe in numbers more than pictures. So here, population has grown up by 3.4 times. Density has gone up by 2.7 times. What is interesting is per capita GDP grew by 137 times, not 137%, 137 times. That means good political policies and good planning can make a change. And why do I include 2010? Because by 2010, our per capita GDP caught up with USA. Yeah, okay, not 2020, it's 2010. So I just want to say that this is really world record. In 25 years, Singapore became a world-class city, from a very backward city to become no squatters, no homeless, no ghettos, no ethnic enclaves. And thanks to the public housing policy, and also in 50 years, our per capita GDP caught up with USA. And how? Why do we do that? It's not by luck. It's a lot of bloody hard work behind it and hard thinking. So intelligent policy by the government and intelligent planning. And I'm saying this, of course, we are proud of that, but I just want to say that if we have intelligent policy and intelligent planning, it can happen in any city in the world. And it's my wish that this intelligent policy of Singapore, intelligent planning of Singapore, is better known across the world so that more and more cities in the world can really transform in a short time. Okay, how do we do the transformation? Let me first talk about the planning. What do we do? Okay, in terms of planning, I would like to say in terms of urban development, you see the light blue is the sky. When you come to a city, you see the transformation. In the shallow water, some people just vaguely think that the transformation is maybe because of some planner doing some planning work. It's not paying much attention, but vaguely understand it. But almost nobody knows that behind the urban plan, you need intelligent planning, you need urban culture. Intelligent planning by planners, urban culture by the government. You need a good urban culture, the political leader to support and endorse intelligent planning before you can do urban plan. And only after that you can see the transformation. So this is the whole ecosystem that we need for every city, and fortunately it took place and happened in Singapore. So let me talk about this urban plan. How did we produce that? And so these are the contents. You see, I only came back to Singapore in 1969. So before that, 1960, our government had to start making transformation. And they were very conscious of the fact that we must really change Singapore to rise above the third world stigma. They were very conscious of that. And through careful thinking, through using common sense, see, common sense is very important also. We don't, in a day of high tech, we talk about technology, data, and so on. We forget the importance of common sense. So through common sense, they decide that they make all this decision. commercial development, industrial development, housing. And from day one, they already start to say we must push for infrastructure. We must pay attention on traffic. And even when we're so poor, we would talk about we must take care of flood control and so on. And actually, despite the fact we were desperately in need of foreign investment, we actually strictly control pollution. And there's stories about that, but I don't have time to tell you. Okay. So this, a lot of these decisions did not come from planners, came from political leaders. We have to be thankful for their very wise decisions that we benefit today. And of course, reclamation is very, very important. But on top of having all these ideas, site selection is very important. You cannot say, oh, I have this great idea, dump it here, great idea, dump it there. That doesn't make Singapore a better place. But our political leaders, this is over time, it's not just from the beginning. Some at the early stages, some over time. They carefully thought through the selection of the sites. For example, industrial area, you know that the petrochemical islands, we wanted there so that in the event of fires and so on, it would not affect the main island. These were, and actually we must give the credit to the British government, but our government held fast to this decision. And of course, this residential area, that came in later by planners, but because of that, we also deliberated for a long, long time in the cabinet. I understood that there was a lot of disagreement, a lot of argument before we selected Changi Airport location. Okay, so this everything was done with a lot of common sense, with a lot of careful, logical thinking, and a lot of debate. And then, of course, with this kind of good foundation, we can put in a sound expressway system. And the other thing that we must thank our political leaders is they, from day one, they worry about the water supply, so they protected all the reservoirs. But I think professionals should take some credit as well. So otherwise, they would not continue to study architecture. So how do we put this intelligent plan together? I just give you some of the key points, okay? And let me take you through. Vision, when I was asked to become the chief planner of Singapore, I told my minister, I said, our vision is towards a unique tropical city of excellence. It took me and my colleagues 6 months to come up with this statement. 6 months. Because we want to deliver every single word in here. One is unique. We have to capture the unique features of Singapore and the weather. Two, it's tropical, okay, the weather. And excellence, because we want it to be a world class. But what is equally important is the word city, because most modern cities anywhere in the world, Asia, Africa, America, Europe, most modern cities are just American suburbs. They are not cities. So because modern planners don't know what is a city, so they just plan suburbs and call it a city. So every one of this word was incorporated in my 1991 concept plan. Okay, it took me 6 months to come up with this statement. My successor actually came out a city to live, work, and play, and I told them, why don't we say a healthy and beautiful city, just rather than any old city. And it's not just live, work, and play, but to learn, because in Singapore, our only resource is human being, and also to move, because what are the biggest problem of almost every single city? Traffic jam. But anyway, I raised this in 2001. Now it's 2022. No reply. intelligent planning is a lot of precision. So my belief that a good planning must do a lot of quantification. It's a quantitative approach to planning and not just conceptual approach. So actually it took me a long time to work out to say that I want to plan for 100 years, because I felt that Singapore with no hinterland, if I plan until today, the world is planning for 15 to 20 years, I want 100 years. But I was scared that that was in 1989, I was scared that if I use the word 100, there will be a revolt in Singapore and they will ask government to kick me out of URA. So to be cunning, a good planner must be cunning, I use year X, so there was no protest. But I thought this is 5.5 million, took a lot of debate to decide, and the density took a lot of calculation to decide. I thought I was really pretty responsible in calculating what we need in the urban plan. But later did I realize that the 100-year target was 2091, but we reached in 2019, we already surpassed 5.5 million. No. Did I make an error? Yes, of course I did. But behind that, there's another very important message, and that is, if your government policy is good, your plan is intelligent, you cannot stop population growth. Because if good policy and good plan, you have very rapid economic development, you create a big amount of jobs, you need population. And partly because of that, 7-8 years ago, I said, I think we should plan for 10 million. I'm still waiting for a response from the government, 7-8 years. But I'm a patient man. And also, the job of a planner is to translate words and data into spatial arrangement. Because if a political leader say, I want this, I want this, I want this, and the planner say, yes, I'll do this, I'll do this, without knowing how to translate that into the plan, it's just a waste of words. Okay, that's why the word intelligence is important. And the job of a planner is to translate words and data into spatial arrangement. That's why I use the word intelligent planning. Okay, but to do so, I just want to say that because the urban planning is very complex, I just highlight to you some of the key, because a city plan is a summary of a lot of subsystems into a big, well-coordinated big system. There are many, but I'll just show you some of the key ones. Let me show you the plan, the maps here. We talk about city planning, and I want to say that if I say I want to draw an elephant, and I draw it without a long nose and the tusk, even a little kid 3 years old will say, this is a wrong drawing. But if I say I want to do a plan, and then if the plan is very bad or very good, almost nobody knows, because few people have a definition of what is a city. So I actually took a lot of trouble, even when I was in HDB, to tell myself, what is a city? This is a model of a city. This model guided me in HDB and in URA, but I could not use this model as it is, because to adapt it to Singapore, this is a model I use in Singapore. Okay. So our plan is not based on my fertile imagination. That doesn't have any value. It's based on a lot of thinking, a lot of research. And based on that, again, I just want to say, to remind you that we protect nature first. So I ask my staff to check through all the areas that we must protect and treat them as land not available. And also ask my colleagues to, they spend about 18 months producing this plan, okay? And you can see that the red dots, historical, they are all near the center, because under the British government, they only care about the British lifestyle and the richer locals' lifestyle. The outside is all squatters. But still, anyway, we still have quite a few thousand historical buildings to preserve. And after having analyzed the traffic, at that time I worked closely with PWD, Public Works Department. We heard that we should have 5 MRT corridors, five urban corridors, and these are the key MRT structure. The blue and the red lines are the key MRT structure, and where they cross each other, we put the key commercial centers, so that Singapore will become a MRT-oriented, public transportation-oriented city. And this is a vision, but it's also delivered today. And I often tell people that a city is not one body. A city is a family. If we treat a city as one body with only one commercial center in the CBD, that means all the people, all the cars, traffic will concentrate on coming to the center. What does it mean? Traffic jam. Okay. Being conscious of that, I divide the city into 5 regions with 5 regional centers and divert the traffic outside into a region. But because of that, the regional centers get traffic jam. So that's no good. So then we put the, now it's 24 new towns, and then divert the traffic into the new towns. This is a plan to explain why in Singapore we don't have serious traffic jam. Of course, it's helped by the MRT line as well. Okay, so MRT line and the expressway are carefully interrupt and also carefully related to the urban family, the new towns and so on. And there's one thing that I would say urban planning profession hardly ever talk about is urban organs, because the key industrial area, infrastructure provision, commercial area, you have to put them at the right places. If you put the lung here and the breathing organ here, the person will become a sick person. You have to put everything at the right place. And fortunately, with the guidance or with a good starting point by our political leaders, we in Singapore, our key urban organs are very well placed. Okay. So this term, urban organs, I would say I'm the only one who uses it for city planning, but it's very important. It actually helps us to have good urban environment, a good functional city. So to put all these things together, there are many other smaller things, but just stack them all together. So that actually is the background behind this 1991 concept plan. So when people see this, say, so what? I can color this in half a day. That's why urban planning is not well respected as it should be. That's why, that's my key message of today's talk. It's a comprehensive long-term urban system. Okay, so if you put them together beautifully, it can become majestic and beautiful like the Phoenix, and that's for 100-year plan. But if we do it for 15 years, and our current urban plan is up to 2030, so that's 8 years, it becomes a collection of small projects and 50 turkeys if you have small plan. That's why long-term plan is very important. Now, after the big picture, you have to do that as a foundation. We have to go into detail. Like Newtown, this is the diagram you saw earlier. It's what is a city? And in the city, where are the new towns? This is a new town. It's just a tiny little yellow square with a few red dots. But I also developed a new town prototype. This is the basic structure. This is the land use. Again, it took me a few years to do this when I was in HDB. Okay. And how do I apply on a plan? Take Bishan as example. Okay. You can see that every new town is planned with this kind of detail. But the detail is not based on my whims and fancy or wanting to put color here and there. It's based on the diagram on the left. But below the, but behind the new town, we actually organize the new town into neighborhoods with neighborhood center. And below the neighborhood, we even organize them into precincts. Now, the word precinct as a vocabulary, as a planning jargon, doesn't exist in other urban plans. This was created in Singapore with the help of, at that time, I had 12 sociologists with PhD degree, and after discussing with them, they came up with this idea. Okay, so I did not allow myself to bulldoze my idea in the plan. Everything was the result of discussion, research, database, and quantity base. Newtown is very important, but also CBD is very important because CBD is the engine head of our service industry. So where is the CBD? Okay, just a patch of yellow color. But inside, again, I did a lot of study. So see what actually is a CBD. And it's not just a CBD core, but CBD fringe as well. So it's based on this, I plan the CBD. How do you apply on the site? Okay, this is a central region. And the central area is really in the black box. And you enlarge it, it's like this. This is a part of the 1991 concept plan. But if you, I have to go into detail to do the detailed CBD plan, okay? Not only that, at that time I was a bit, I just felt that I needed, because CBD is very important to a city, it's like the image of the entire city. I was nervous about this, so I convinced the government to ask IMPE, with whom I worked for 4 years, to produce urban design for me, for Singapore. Okay, and he's got a very nice civic exit line, okay, facing Marina South. And also the shorelines are very clean. You can walk along here and see the water readily. I try to do so now. So, but people do not respect the precision and the intelligence behind an urban plan, and therefore, what you see today is not this. It's this. Change for the sake of changing. So please, young people, don't just change for the sake of changing. Everything you do must be well argued out. This is no match for what I saw earlier. And the rest I'll just show you, besides this thing, how to transform the older part of the city to something new, how to capture some of the valuable assets. I'll just flip through this quickly. Urban renewal, you can see. So as a planner, besides planning, you also have to do urban renewal. This one, of course, all of you love, Old Army Camp, and in the area which is with a lot of high-class, expensive land, but fortunately, I managed to convince the government to save this. Even Changi Village, we're trying to keep it like a village. Kampong, I really, just now I mentioned, I regret I did not save the old squatter areas, and I actually have been trying to ask a few ministers to save this because it has both Malay and Chinese kampong together in Ubin. I'm still waiting for a reply. Look how beautiful. On the main island, you hardly see, can't find it anymore. In fact, I wanted this to be saved as for future as a kind of important venue for international conference. So instead of coming to our central area, which is the same everywhere, you go to this place for a kind of a camp for exchange ideas. It has economic value, but I'm still waiting for answer. But I'm very patient. And of course, riverfront, you know that. Huge difference. And of course, the river, I just often like people to say that when I was young, I could blindfold myself and know that I'm in Singapore River. Why? You smell the soup. And even district conservation, Chinatown before and after, okay, and Kampong Glam. See, we respect all our ethnic groups. Little India. Even the European towns. Because if we do that, see, to the Chinese, the Chinese culture can be, not entirely, but at least we have a place to go to savor the Chinese lifestyle. Malay, you have Arab Street. In fact, Malay, yeah, it's Arab Street, but I think it's better known as Kampong Glam. No? India, you have Little India, and then European, you have Padang area. And we also, the historical building, which is segregate between conservation and preservation. Conservation, a building of slightly less important. Preservation would be monuments. So, and the rules governing how to restore is stricter for preservation. This is this was originally preserved by me. Okay, you can see that. Make sure that the Malay population, they have something they are proud of to show their visitors. I also was involved in the preservation of this one when I was in the government. Nowadays we take the beauty of historical building for granted. Actually, it was a lot of hard work because in the early days, until the mid-70s, both Singaporeans and the government could not care less about historical buildings because in those days, the 90% of the historical building looked like the one on the left, blackened by moss. But fortunately, at that time, I was engaging in HDB, engaging a French contractor to help us do prefabrication. And so occasionally I would sit down with them to have, with the engineers to have lunch. And one of the lunches, they said, "Mr. Liu, we just cannot bear to see that your historical building gets pulled down one after another, week after week." I said, "We'd like to help." I said, "What can you do?" He said, "Just nominate one building for me, for us to paint the facade, just to show Singaporeans how beautiful they are." And of course, I'm kind of preservationist at heart, so I picked this one, number 9 New Road. In fact, I'm hoping that the government would nominate this as the monument of all monuments because this building changed the fate of our historical buildings. And you see, the outside is like this. Inside is still a holy mess. But by painting the facade like this, change the government's viewpoint, change the citizens' viewpoint. After that, I had little problem in convincing the government and the citizens to preserve historical building. So sometimes in urban planning, we need champions. We need these French engineers to that paint to be champions to help us change the fate of historical building. And I want to say that the story behind, the moral behind this story is that actually to me, historical buildings are Cinderellas. It's in a kitchen, dirty, unwashed, and with the torn clothes. And once she happened to meet a prince, clean up, and knew she became a princess. So I in Singapore, this story is no longer important because we already accept historical buildings. But I tell this story in other cities to say, please, for heaven's sake, don't demolish your Cinderella. They're all princesses. Nature protection, of course, is very important too. Okay. And there's one thing I've done that I would say I guarantee not a single one here knows that I've done it, is I preserved 2 kilometers long of beachfront in Changi. Because Singapore being so small, we reclaim everywhere. So I just asked myself, how do I let our future generation know what our original beaches are like? So I preserved this one. And our original beaches are beautiful. You can see, if you go there, Changi Beach and Changi Creek are there. But until today, there is not a sign to say this is our original beach. Okay. So I don't know whether, how long it will stay untouched. So I think This is also something, because there's a Chinese saying that a sparrow may be very small, but has all the organ of a big animal. And I feel that Singapore, tiny as it is, I did not allow that to be an excuse to say, well, since we are so tiny, we don't have this, we don't have this. I want everything. I want the beach, I want the forest, I want lakes, I want historical building. I'm just a very tamsim person. Okay, greedy as hell. But easy to say that, to get it done is bloody difficult. So in summary of all these changes, I want to say that our first generation politicians and planners turn problems into opportunities. And I hope younger generation would know that we should preserve this spirit, okay? Because massive squatters, we clear them, we create land for new development. Limited land, so we have to plan long-term plan. No resources, so we put on, focus on education and so on. And we're not going to. So if we think in bigger picture, in holistic way, we can turn problems into opportunities. And this kind of spirit, I really would like younger. In those days, of course, we did out of desperation. But personally, Singapore, being a tiny, tiny country, surrounded by, I would say, the top, China, India, Indonesia, the three out of the top five largest countries in the world, we must realize that we continue to have, we continue to have a crisis of survival. And therefore, if we are too complacent, we will not, we will be sorry in time to come. This crisis mentality, it must be with us. Okay, then that's a story of Singapore. And the just go back to this big picture. So we did the plan, but behind the plan, we must have this intelligent planning approach and not just producing sexy-looking color drawings. Okay? Now, what are the key points? Three essential ingredients. And I also want to say that we must pay attention to the environmental ambience, because we, you know, I think nowadays there's a kind of new superstition that anything that's exciting and wild is good. I don't agree with that. We must be differentiated. Okay, so I'm just take you through quickly. Essential ingredient is we must have a scientist's head. That's a key to intelligent planning, because a city is a machine for living. We must have a scientist's head to design a perfect machine for living. But what is this machine designed for? Designed for humanistic reason. Machine is designed for the well-being of people, for the sustainability of the land. Okay? It's not for sexy images, it's for people and land. But this machine, when you put it on the land, you cannot just put the machine as it is. It will just destroy the land. So we must have, in artist's eyes, to romance with the land. And now you understand why, given my young age, I look so old, because I romance with a lot of land and got jilted. So don't be a planner. You get jilted all the time. Just now I mentioned this humanist heart for people and land. So the purpose of planning is for people and land. Okay. People, livable, resilient, land functional, sustainable. And behind that, one is to design the and construct, one is to create some policy. It's a combination of government policy and planning. And one is hardware, one is software. And behind those objectives, there are still many little considerations you have to consider. So that's why I said planning is, you have to use intelligence to plan. There are a lot of things to think about. I won't go through this with you, but I want to say that when I prepared the 1991 plan, all these things were considered. So one is science and art, one is value, and one is intelligent planning, one is intelligent administration. Okay, I won't go through that. So this is humanist art. And given the humanist art, for heaven's sake, don't allow yourself to be seduced by untested, sexy slogans. But a lot of young people tend to be seduced because sexy slogan is so high-sounding. Okay. Nowadays, we talk about disruption becomes a fashionable term, but you must know the real meaning. Future ready is on everybody's lips. But how can you be future ready if you don't know what is present and the past? And icon, okay, Singapore, I care about icon, except I don't talk about iconic buildings. I talk about creating Singapore as an iconic city. Now, that's a lot harder, a lot less gratifying, but if you manage to achieve it, it's much more beneficial to the people and the land. And smart city, of course, innovation. See, I often feel that Singaporeans, being not terribly good in our language, we confuse innovation with novelty. A lot of what you think is innovation is, to my mind, is just simple novelty. Scientist hat. You design a city like a machine. It has to be very precise. You must know the purpose. You must know the system of putting a machine together. You must know what each part means. You must know the dimension and quantity and how to put them in. This is not theory. I put all this thing inside my plan. How many of us really have a clear idea what is a city, what's a region, and so on? How can you describe it? How can you put number to it? Okay. In fact, what is MRT? What's a tram? How do they fit into the urban plan? What is a CBD? In fact, recently I had some dealing with a foreign country, and I told them, your huge city does not have a CBD. I said, no, we have CBD everywhere. Okay, they don't even know what is the definition of CBD. That's why they don't have CBD. So if we don't have a definition of the trend planning jargon, there's no way to plan a good city. Okay. So the design of a machine must face a reality. Do all the necessary things. And one thing that I want to emphasize is recognizing a problem, of course, is a big achievement. But our first generation political leader had something even better. They could see and anticipate problem coming and started formulating policy to solve the problem before the problem became out of hand. That's part of the reason our transformation was so fast, is anticipation. Okay. Not wait for the problem to, oh, you see how clever I am? I now know the problem. Okay, then I'll start forming a committee to discuss. They don't say forming a committee to solve problems, just to discuss. So the government is very important. And we must make long-term and sustainable master plan. Because if we do the plan well, personally, I feel that we can improve the sustainability of Mother Earth. Of course, sustainability of Mother Earth depends on many things. Depends on urban planning, depends on good engineering, depends on high tech and so on. It's a combination. But everybody talks about technology, talk about smart tech. Nobody talks about good planning as part of the element to contribute to sustainability. So a city is a system. So under the city, just now you saw, we have regions, you have new towns, neighborhoods. Below that, we have precincts, but there are too many, I couldn't fit it in. And after then you have to put all these elements together into one coherent whole in an orderly way, in an efficient way, in a logical way. But many cities don't do that. I think you just try to recall a lot of cities you go to, the city looks like this. They just throw projects together. Don't tell me you haven't been to a city like this. It's a collection of projects, not a system. But this one doesn't apply to Singapore, but since I'm talking about city, I will also say that mega city, a city is a family, not a body. A city is not a body, it's a family. Mega city is not a family, it's a clan. Because you have to divide the city into a collection of cities, then below that you have the region and so on. And this is certainly highly applicable to China, India, Indonesia, Jakarta included. And why do I come up with this idea? Let me entertain you with the next slide. You see, if you treat a megacity like one body, it's like putting the weight of 5 or 6 person on one human body. Does it look healthy? But a lot of plants done this way. But if you divide them into, say, 2 or 3 cities, well, it looks a little bit better, still not healthy. But if you divide further, that means distribute the weight to other people. It looks even better. But if you do it properly with careful calculation as to how many cities you need in this mega city, so in fact, China, India, Indonesia need this concept to solve their urban problem. And of course, below the city, you divide into regions and then new towns and so on. So you have to subdivide. And this one, I would, in terms of time, I will go through faster. When you put the amenities, the land use and facilities into a city, you have to think in terms of what are the components. And animation is wrong. It should be this way, clockwise. The component and hierarchy, because once you know hierarchy, you know it is service radius, how big, and then how do you mix them together and so on. Now, this, when you allocate a land use, you have to have this in mind. Again, not theory. I practiced this in my new town, in my 1991 concept plan. Then the next one is artist's eyes. Of course, we have to respect nature. And then we have to make sure that the city is both an efficient machine and also a work of art. And this is something I want to emphasize. Try, as an architect or planner, try to remember we are not the master of the land. We are the servant of the land. Because if we are a servant, we want our design form or urban plan to follow the functions. But the function must follow what gives people fun, okay? Makes people happy. And then you create, you identify the function, then you do the form. So we don't say, oh, I've got this great idea, take it or leave it. No, that's not my idea. A good planner, a good architect must be the servant to the city or to the building. And try to avoid this. To me, this is a main reason why a lot of cities are so badly designed. Is in order to become famous overnight, they follow fashionable designs, and the form just is created that way. Now that is, to me, is not our core mission as architect and planner. Because if we do it intelligently, okay, then the city will have spiritual beauty, inner beauty, outer beauty, like a human being. And in doing so, people live in a healthy place, beautiful place. They have nostalgia. And that, to me, is also very important. The next thing is, you see, nowadays we want our environment to be exciting, sexy everywhere. In fact, I'm deeply worried that we want Orchard Road to become sexy. Actually, Orchard Road is one of the 10 most respected shopping streets in the world. And because it's not sexy, that's why it's respected. If we're trying to make it sexy and create a kind of chaos and dysfunction, we're going to lose that status. Okay, so I want to say that when we create environment, one is urban planning starts with a population. The larger the population, the higher will be the density. The larger population city is like a lady, a kind of dignified lady, noble lady, but a lot of other cities, no matter how tiny your city is, there's still one 50 to 100 story tall blocks. I don't care for that. Because the smaller city, we must keep the city density low, building low, so that it has a beauty of like a country less. Big city is like a duty of a dignified ladies. The beauties are different, but a dignified lady, when she goes to a countryside, she will be very envious of the lovely charm of a country girl. So don't try to do everything large and tall. That's why in Singapore, you saw earlier, I preserve all kinds of environment so that you can, when you move around Singapore, small as it is, you can savor a wide variety of the environment that people in a larger city would have enjoyed. Okay. know, urban ambience is that, to my mind, there are three types of urban ambience and three types of urban functions. Something that you do daily, something you do occasionally, like going to a museum and so on, something you do in a very special occasion, like tourism, going to theme parks. So, for heaven's sake, don't make our environment in our daily activities to be exaggerated, sexy like a theme park. But that seems to be the tendency everywhere, including Singapore now. So we must have different ambience for different types of function. Okay. I'm saying this because as a young architect, I want you to be aware that there's no such thing as one single exciting, sexy, wild environment for the whole world. There are different types of environment, different types of ambience. And in terms of the daily environment, because that one occupies probably 95% of the city's land area, I just want to say that it must be harmonious. Like the building is like a member of a choral group. Okay, and then it sprinkled with a few soloists. And the scale must be well controlled. Building setback in Singapore, a lot of people like Singapore because when I was a chief planner, I controlled the building setback line quite rigidly. Maybe some people accuse me to be dictatorial, but the result speaks for itself. People like Singapore because it's so tidy. And also when you walk around the street, you have buildings accompanying you. But in many other cities, the buildings go back and forth and forth. So you have to jump from one building to another. So this kind of very basic, commonsensical dealing of environment, it's not highlighted sufficiently nowadays. The skill must be human skill. But because nowadays we are able to mass produce a lot of buildings, so when I was in the government, I took a lot of trouble to make the city building look organic. For example, just to give you one example, say two pieces of land with the same plot ratio, and with that plot ratio, if you allow them to build to 10 story, you can achieve the plot ratio. I didn't do that. One of them, I may give it 10 story. Another, I may give it 12 story. So you don't build 10, you build 12 and 8 and something. And another one, I may give it 18 story. You'll build 18 and 6 and so on. So you look at the Singapore skyline of the plan created during my time. It's organic. You go to a lot of other developing cities, you go there, the roofscape is, using the word that I knew as a kid was botanhead. Just everything is flat. In Singapore, you don't, certainly in urban scape during my time, you can see all this thing. So there is, because I don't want our city to look like something produced from a factory conveyor belt. It must be something that grows organically. Okay, so a lot of this detail is part of the intelligent planning I'm talking about. So architecture, like the member of choral group, must be harmony. But then you have a few soloists to give accents. And when I was in URA, I had to nervously present to my minister to say, in Singapore, I would only identify 12 locations for iconic buildings. All the rest must follow the rules. I was nervous, but thank goodness the minister accepted my recommendation. But now there are more than 12. I lost count. You know why it's so important? because we love Paris, you know, old Paris, not the new Paris. We love Paris, you know why? The beauty of Paris is that 99.9% of the buildings in old Paris is unbearably boring. But because they're unbearably boring, so the Eiffel Tower, the Triumphal Arch and so on stand out. But if everyone is exciting, you can't even see Eiffel Tower. That's why in Singapore, during my time, I only allowed 12 sites carefully selected for iconic building. All the rest must be like members of choral group. They must follow the rules. I think I'm going to skip it a bit faster. This one, I want to say, as architects, when we design something, it's important that we treat building form as a grammar of the grammar of our message. In other words, whatever building we do, we must let people know what this building is about, okay? And also, when we do this, most important is to respect your neighbors. You design something, the first thing I do normally as an architect is I will put all the surrounding building on the drawing and see how my building relate to that. I got this bad habit from Ian Pei. Ian Pei's, you see Ian Pei's drawing, there's not one drawing that draws his own building as an island. He always surrounded with all the surrounding building and see how his building can relate to that. And there's a simple word for that. I don't know whether nowadays it's still in use. Contextualism. Okay. But I see a lot of buildings now without any sense of contextualism. It's just an island with no regard to the neighbors. So to my mind, modern, our building today must be modern, of course, but we must respect local environment. And what is important is we must capture the ethnicity, the design gene of our own culture. So avoid blind pursuit of European style. Because if you look back on historical building, every historical building that we love were contemporary buildings of its time. So today, we should not hesitate to create a contemporary building, but for heaven's sake, remember to capture our architectural design gene so that, and don't just blindly copy the European architecture from the European and American magazines. So this is just a quick summary. So for planning, translate words and data into scientific and quantifiable drawing of spatial arrangement. Urban component is like the human organ. Urban image is like human body. Okay. Urban images we do through urban design. This one, I just read through it from. I just want to say that we have high respect for doctors because their job is very, very tough. If you don't do it well, you may kill the patient. But personally, I feel that don't underestimate the toughness of the urban planner. Because the beauty of a doctor is that he is trying to cure a human body which is already designed. But the challenge to urban planner is that we are trying to create a city where the definition, the design is not there yet. Until today, it's not there. There is no common understanding of what is a city. There's no common understanding what is a new town. Okay. But we don't feel that our task is difficult. Why? Because if you do a good job, the result will not be known till 15, 20 years later. If you do a lousy job, the problem will not appear until 15, 20 years later. So you're free to just bullshit your way through. That is a problem. That's what I'm saying in this game. So I would like to say that, because in medicine, if you have a heart problem, you get a heart specialist. If you have something else, you get some other specialist. And they are all doctors, they are not nurses. But in urban planning, because you don't see the result immediately, so you can have urban entertainer, people who shout sexy slogans to plan your city. Or you can have a beautician, they just touch up, make the drawing look very pretty, you become a planner. A lot of plans are done this way. Or mechanics, they fix a little bit of problem in small area. So a lot of these people are engaged to do urban planning. At least we must have urban doctor to understand what a city is about, to plan the city. But urban doctor, the result of his curing will be known within a few days. A medical doctor, but an urban doctor, the result will not be known until 15, 20 years later. So a better planner, to my mind, is a prophet. That means whatever you plan today, you must be able to predict 15, 20 years later what the city will be like. It is a tall order, but it is necessary to do this for the good development of cities around the world. So a good planner must be the servant to provide the needs of the people in the land. Just like a good doctor is also a servant. You cannot say, I'm a doctor, I'm so creative, I just do whatever I like, and cut here, cut there. No doctor dares to do that. But a planner says, oh, I change it here, draw a line here. Because your mistake will not be known in intelligent planning. The reason I built up all these theories is because when I was in HDB, I did all these things. Acquire land, resettle, plan new towns, design the neighborhoods and so on, design architecture, develop, and what is valuable is property management. When you have property management, you have a lot of complaints. I had two choices with the complaint. One is to dump them into waste paper basket. But stupid me organized 5 or 6 research units, engineers, architects, real estate, and also one that's very important, very few organizations have, sociologists. So after we do the research, so it's a rare laboratory, and as a result of that, I did plan 20 new towns, 200,000 per new town, and few of you realize that I'm also, until today, probably the largest developer in Singapore. Thanks to the government, I developed 500,000 units of flats. But what is important is not this, is that because of the feedback and research, I plow back the information to planning, to design to architecture. And this is circulated 20 years. Can you imagine? So everything I said beforehand was not through imagination, it's through this kind of experience. And having been spoiled by this kind of experience when I was in URA, I also asked for feedback. In other words, when I was in URA, I used to, when the developer wanted to apply for approval of his development, I put a column there to ask them to fill in any suggestion for amendment of the URA regulation or master plan. And I would say every now and then, in those days, I would say every 3 to 4 months, I'll make some adjustment to the regulations through the Gazette. Because I feel that, on the one hand, I appreciate that HDB or URA has strong power, but I also realize that given the strong power, you must give people a chance to give you feedback so that because nobody can be fully aware of his own mistakes. You need some feedback. This is just for fun. You see, in summary of everything I've said, in Chinese classic, you have this Ren Zi Chu and so on. And I hope that SUTD students, you want to learn how to plan city very well, please memorize what I've written. It's mine, 3-character classic, okay? They must pass this in order to get your degree. I wouldn't waste time. Okay? Summarize, recite this, memorize it, then you become a good planner. This is more or less a summary of everything I said earlier. How much time do I have? Nearly time.
Yeah, but please take your time.
Okay, I'll try to rush a little bit. No, the last part is not so long. So having gone through this, okay, I've just went through the intelligent planning, but actually what is very, very important is urban culture, because without the strong government support during my time, under Mr. Lee and his cabinet colleagues, I could not have done anything. I got their support, that's very important. So let me tell you these two things. Again, to develop a city well, you need 3 ingredients. You must have the government whose heart is on improving the quality of life of people, including the functionality and ecology of a city. With that one, then you produce a plan. And I put a take here, the plan I've already explained. And also, for the plan, if the plan is planned according to the optimal functionality and beauty, you must put your development at the right places on the land. So, and a lot of cities have this problem. That means the government's power to implement plan is not strong, and the government cannot find the land. Even if you have a plan, they cannot find the piece of land at that precise location for development. But in Singapore, our government did all that. So we must be thankful to our government particularly the first generation of a government, to lay this very good foundation for subsequent generations. So this is three essential ones. I explained earlier, so I would not repeat. Strong government, having a land for you to put the function that precisely you must put, rather than compromise, put it at the wrong place. And we did that in Singapore. And how did the government help us? Because Singapore, after all, is still a democracy. It's not a socialist country. You don't have opposition. We do have. And how did we manage to have so much power to do it? That's because we actually thought through, our government thought through every problem very carefully, and not just by gut feeling. There's a lot of common sense behind that. So I often tell people that the success of Singapore government, if I have to use two words to describe it, clarity equal courage. That means you think through if you issue clearly, then you have the courage to bulldoze it. And one glaring example is that at the time we introduced a public housing policy and we went for high-rise, high-density public housing, that was in the early 60s. It was condemned by the world-leading experts all over the world, because in Europe and America, there was no successful high-density public housing. But our government still had the courage to do so, because our government realized that if you don't do so, you cannot house everybody. We don't have enough land. So after having made that policy, then they left the job to me. So I used to go to Europe every year, about two or three times, each time 1 or 2 weeks, to visit all those high-density housing, talk to the experts and so on, talk to the managers and so on, to find out what's wrong. And I, after having identified the problems, came back, then through design and through the mixing of residents and so on, was trying to eliminate all those problems. Because after a few visits, I realized that the high-density public housing is not intrinsically a problem. The problem is the operation. So in the operation and in the design, if you avoid that, we can have successful public housing. And HDB today proves to the world that it can be done. So again, this is about intelligent approach. And clarity is very important. So in Singapore, you can see that in the early 60s, we already did a lot of things, which is hard to imagine when we were so poor, and yet we insisted on pollution control. When I look back, I said, well, I asked myself, do I have the courage to do it myself? Probably not. And yet our political leader was committed to that. Okay, we must be thankful to them. And then, so you can see that there's a kind of logical progression of the policies. So a government, and also the another beauty of government is that the roles, the responsibility, and the result to be produced by each government agency was clearly stated. And there's no ambiguity about it. Okay, that's another one. And also, just some of the job cannot be handled by government agencies. So our government created special action committees to solve this problem. Like, I think the young people cannot believe that we used to have broken footpaths everywhere, okay? No, you don't see it. In no way you see it. In fact, when I used to go to Europe, I said one or two or three times a year, I was so envious of Paris, where the footpaths were just so smooth, so beautiful. Five or six years ago, I went to Paris. I said, wow, the world has changed. We don't have broken footpaths. In Paris, there are broken footpaths in many, many places. The world has changed. What is the change? I think it's the government. And also, we have legislations to remove the symptoms of backward city. Removing symptoms of backward city was the slogan of my time. Okay? And therefore, we created a series of the legislation to make it work. And of course, COE is very much in the news nowadays. We're not going to do it, just to say that through wanting the agency to be very clear about what should they should deliver, through creating special units to solve problems that's outside the common scope of work of the agency, through legislations, we transform the city in areas that a planner cannot do. We need these people to do it. That's all. You see, we take this for granted. We have trees, and the signage on our buildings is not everywhere. In a lot of country, you can't see the building for the signs. You can't see the beauty of architecture because the signs are covering the beauty of the architecture. But in Singapore, we can do that. Okay, hawker center used to be like this. And when we clear the hawkers in Chinatown, I made it a point to walk through the street to see what the new street would look like. Yes, I did not see any hawker, but I did see something I did not expect. Rats running all over the street. So you see, in Singapore nowadays, any visitor come to Singapore said, come to hawker center, you are safe, it's very hygienic. But in those days, if you ask a visitor go to this hawker in the street, he may not go back home in a healthy state. So all these changes we take for granted, but it actually behind that, though, I'm saying this to say that whenever there are new problems in our city, please don't just wait for it to happen and then try to solve it. And in fact, I want to add one more statement, which is not here. In our early stage of the government, we had master plan for everything. Whenever there's a problem, we created a master plan to solve the problem in its totality. Okay, so this is basically to say that we have a master plan for everything. And also we solve causes, not symptoms. Okay, this is, I think maybe I would just say that this is a description of Singapore's government in early days. That means the urban planning responsibility from left to right. Those that the government must do, our government took the responsibility to do it. Those that the government need not do, we did not do, because we want to give the private sector the freedom to do whatever they want. We want to give the architects the freedom to express itself, but within the regulation. So this is a description of our administration. The beauty of that is, because the green part is the political leaders, the orange part is the professionals in Singapore. The professionals because in those days, I would say the professional agency was stronger. So they were they are freer to mix with the citizens than the politicians. So they got a lot of feedback from the citizens. And with that feedback, they pass it to the politicians and therefore help politicians to make better decisions. So that's just part of a story of how Singapore transformed so quickly and so well. Okay, but in many other cities I've been to, the political leaders love architecture too much, and therefore in the process have no time to do the things that he had to do. And when you have no time to do the thing you have to do, the developer will say, oh, can I suggest you do this? They have no time, they'll say, oh yes. That's how chaos starts to happen. But this is a typical model of most cities. And let's try to avoid that. Basically, I just want to say that when you have good planning, okay, the beauty of Singapore is that we have one planning agency and we have one enforcement agency within. So UR is both planning agency and enforcement agency. But fearing that the power of UR is too strong, so we within UR we have the master plan committee consisting of different government departments whose work could affect the planning of Singapore. And every time we make a change in a plan, it must be discussed with the Master Plan Committee. So this kind of organization is both efficient and yet very all-embracing. Okay, in looking back, I would say a lot of these things, we must thank our first generation government for really having the intelligence to create such a good environment for us to operate. Okay, this you can read, I will not repeat this. The important thing is that having trust between the government and the citizen through your own action, through your own delivery, is most important. In fact, once I asked a friend of mine, a very rich friend of mine, I said, do you know that I was in HDB? Do you know I'm acquiring your land? She said, yes. I said, what are you going to do about it? She said, of course, nothing. I said, why not? I said, because the people is on the government side, what can I do? So trust is very important. Land, of course, is very important. And almost every city has compulsory land acquisition act, but we use it in a large amount. Why? Because of trust. Because we deliver what we promise. Okay, I will not go into the detail. Just say we deliver what we promise, so we have trust. Just to show you what we have done. In 1949, let me see, I think it's 1959, we had 31% crown land, okay, handed over by the British. But then you can see that we continue to use our Land Acquisition Act to increase the state-owned land. And on top of that, we also do reclamation. Reclamation, of course, belongs to the state. That's how today's Singapore government has a lot of land to put our projects at the right location at the right time. That's very important. But I just want to add that Singapore government, at least during my time, my understanding is that we did not want to own 100% of the land in government's hand. We want to keep around 20-30% in private sector. Why? In order to know the true market value of our land. Because private sector, through private transaction, because government, whatever we decide to fix as land prices, up to a point is a little bit artificial. So we need it. So you can see that our government, on the one hand, has a lot of power. On the other hand, try to be as market-oriented as possible. Yeah, this is what I want to say. I hope our young audience, you remember that because we have this crisis mentality, we were determined to survive. How to survive? First, we must know what we need to do. We must believe in our ability to deliver. So we have to sharpen our skills, and then in doing so, we achieve world-class standard. And everything we did, was aiming at world-class. We did not allow ourselves to do temporary design. We did in the beginning. And then at one time we had this emergency one-room flat and so on. But that was stopped within a few years. Everything else after that was aimed for permanency. That changed our destiny. And I will feel that given how tiny Singapore is, surrounded by huge countries, this quality still must be observed today. Okay, the rest is a bit faster. The rewards. Okay, that means finally, after going through this, we try to reap our reward, okay? In my own words, ecology is fine. You just read it, I will not. Environment is also, what is important is in our master plan, I torture my staff to calculate the spaces we need for every single citizen for every kind of activities. It took them, I think, a year or so to calculate. You ask them, what is your impression of Singapore, of Mr. Liu Thai Ker? I would say the word is torture. you remember. Because we must be responsible. You cannot say, I want so many square meters. What for? It must be for how many people, what kind of land users, and according to what standard. I use world standard for that. So this was all calculated. That's why I say quantification is a very big part of Singapore's urban planning. Infrastructure, I think, is well known. And just now I mentioned that no squatter, no homeless. Until today, even New York City, Paris, London, they still cannot live up to this four sentence. And what is also impressive is that in Singapore, around 93% of people own their own homes. I think U.S. is probably just hovering around 50%. So what we did was to plan a city, work on policy for the people and for the land. And I think to describe Singapore in simple words, I feel that just safe, simple, comfortable, convenient, and choice. I just want to emphasize the word safe again. A year or two before Mr. Lee Kuan Yew passed away, I requested for a 1-hour interview with him to kind of wrap up my, because I never sit down and seriously talk to him about his overall concept of urban planning. So I asked for interview to ask him, what is the overall concept of urban planning? And in that 1 hour, he mentioned safety 5 times. So the fact Singapore is a safe place is not by accident. You can have a cake and eat it. How can you imagine that we have 10 runways in a tiny place? And 28 golf courses. In the whole province of Yunnan, we put 46 million people, they have a grand total of 6 golf courses. I want to tell you that, just now I mentioned, good. If you want to have immediate recognition and appreciation, don't be a planner. As a planner, you have to wait a bloody 15 years at least to get recognition. Okay, you can see a lot of our award is first in Asia and quite upfront in the world on our physical environment. You have to wait for 15 years. That's why this is a big challenge of planning, is for people who want to have immediate gratification, they don't do the right thing, they do the sexy things. Even for border urban environment, you still have to wait a few years to do it. It's not immediate gratifications. So good environment, despite the high density, but with good policy, the two are inseparable. You become a world-class city. This is just to show that people know about Singapore, know about me, so I do get to do a lot of job overseas. This is just a very quick one. So, from small one, neighborhood to new town, to region, to city, to the mega city, and the largest city that I had to deal with is 28 million. And you see a lot of that in China. Also, did some urban design, CBD landscape and urban renewal. And what is important is no project is an island. You must always put your plan in the context of a surrounding. And the main reason I continue to work is because I get the client to pay me for free travel around the world. I'm still waiting for people to pay me for free travel to Latin America. Just some example, you can see the, given the intelligent planning, the one on the left is existing plan, and the one on right is my plan. This, the clarity is quite different. City, see, the one on the left is existing, the one, the clarity is important, or even the region. This is quite famous, it's called the Blue Silicon Valley in China. It's trying to emulate the Silicon Valley, except this one, the focus is on the research of marine-related research. new town, this Tatarstan is a republic. That means it's a semi-autonomous province. The president fell in love with the One North, so asked me to do a high-tech park. But I said, no, this area is too far from a city. Let me do a high-tech new town. So instead of 20,000 people, I convinced him to let me do 150,000. As a good planner, you must be cunning. That's not true. You just have to reason with the client. So this, to see whether you can understand this, just now I mentioned planning is a precision science. So just to give you in words, to say when I take somebody's plan, it looks like this, PEA, so it could not make sense. Okay. After I take over, I just add a few things without changing, then it makes sense, right? So, but the local planner, seeing that all I did is just to add a few things, it makes sense. So they also try to... That's why I said I want to romance with the land in every city. I got jilted because they changed my plan to this. I'm saying this to say that the precision of planning is generally not understood, not appreciated around the world. But they don't know that they are not, they're destroying. They think that it's fine. Okay. This is an American saying, when it ain't broke, don't fix it. But they want to fix it. This I think I will not repeat. I think you just to say that there are a lot of, when I go around the cities and around the world, I see a lot of really weaknesses. I will not go through that. You can infer from my talk earlier. The opportunity is that actually in many other cities, the landscape is more beautiful than Singapore. The heritage, the culture is richer than Singapore. So if they plan intelligently, they can be even more attractive than Singapore. So, a lot of people say that how can Singapore's planning experience be relevant to other places? Ours is Asian, it's tropical, it's big. I tell them, this is my commercial. Understanding urban planning principle is like understanding a language. If you master the grammar of a language, you can write any story of any length. If you master the principle of urban planning, you can plan any city or any size. Okay, so what I said to you today is, I'm telling you, I give you some idea of the principle of planning, the grammar of planning. And I also mentioned earlier, my first love is to architecture because I get more satisfaction. Okay, and just to give you some idea of the architecture world. This is in Zhuhai, it's built 22 years ago. My understanding is until today, it still fetches the highest price in Zhuhai, if you plan properly. This is Guilin. I think it's quite well known throughout China now. 58 bungalows, and it's really well loved by a lot of Chinese, and very expensive now. Just now I mentioned that architects must be a member of the choral group. You must sing in harmony. This one is a bit wild. That's because the client gave me a site which is in the middle of a garden. You don't have any immediate neighbors. So I don't feel that I have to respect my neighbors. But at the same time, this city in Weifang is the world capital of kites. Every year in August, they hold a kite competition here. People come from all over the world. So I use the theme of the kite to design this. It's built, and despite the fact that it's a free-flowing shape, it's now the best cultural center in Shandong province. Because the acoustics, the backstage for equipment and so on, they're all very, very scientifically provide them. This is an aerial view of it. This one you probably know. It's a French institute, so I use a French chateau as a theme to show that it has a French connection. This one you probably have seen it. It's in Singapore. Okay. This one I think you are familiar. And it's my understanding is the conservatory is now ranked among the top half dozen in the world. We have good teachers here, good students. This one you have seen. The concept here is like the waves rushing to the shore. But if it's wave, it's curved line, and our tourism board doesn't have the money to do the. So I said to myself, what do? I do cubistic waves. So this is a piece of architectural cubism. This one I'm very proud of. The people in Xiamen, a lot of Singapore businessmen there, they wanted to donate a polyclinic, so they asked the Xiamen government to provide a piece of land, and the government did. So then they would donate this building, and then the consul general from Singapore, Xiamen, came to me to say, I want you to donate the design. What can I say? Oh, okay la. But despite that, I still got a Singapore expert to advise me how to put a clinic well together. So 2 years after that, the central government, Ministry of Health, went to see it and declared this as one of the prototypes of clinics in China. So what I want to say is that whatever you do, under whatever circumstances, for heaven's sake, do it. Do your best. Put in your best effort. This is my grandparents' hometown. It's built, it's been in use since last September, but because of COVID-19, I cannot go to take a photo. This is also already built, but I cannot take a photo. But the beauty of Bhutan is that they insist on the design to capture the architectural gene, which I really feel is it's a wonderful government policy. This one, I'm sure you have been there many times. The form came from a mathematical formula. I did this in collaboration with an English architect. So, in closing, okay. First of all, if you do this thing well, then Singapore succeed, and I still think that we must continue to have this crisis mentality, and we must go for the optimal standard and not just lower standard. And we must do a lot of research, develop a real skill. And when you do that, I feel that the purpose of urban planning is really, I'm going to tell you one or two things that people don't always say. The purpose of urban planning, of course, is to protect ecology, have good environment, good education, and good economics. That's the four E's. But to me, those are just a stepping stone for two even more important purposes, is to earn the unreserved esteem from people around the world, of the people in the city. Okay, to me that's more important. For example, why do we still continue to be very respectful to Europeans, even though their economy is slightly not as good as before? Because their cities are beautiful. So, and the other important thing is, if you plan it scientifically correctly, you may reduce the traffic jam, you reduce the travel distance, and therefore you can contribute to saving the earth. So planning is not just producing a drawing, it's a barometer of civilization. It needs political leaders to embrace sound urban culture and also subscribe to producing intelligent plan. And also the planning process, you cannot just say you want to develop a city, go straight to architecture. This is a simplified process. I will not elaborate, but just to say that in Singapore, during my time, we went through every step of this, in this logical process. And I want to emphasize this circle in a dotted line. These are architect's work. Just to elaborate this. Because the role of architects to urban image is that we are involved in conservation, in planning, urban design, architecture. Okay, and these are the kind of result we produce. The attitude. And not only that, the total image of Singapore, our city, also has engineering design, landscape, street furniture, lighting design, and legislation. And so I just want to say that in good planning, the role of an architect does play a big role. So just don't look at it as just designing a building. You can make a bigger contribution if you understand the full scope of your responsibility and possibility of your contribution. So just remember the word contextualism. It's very, very important. We're not just producing our own individual building. We're producing iconic cities. Okay, look at the larger environment. Then you can, after look at our larger environment, then you create your own building in the context of larger environment into something that's very beautiful. So the two are not in conflict with each other, they complement each other. So my wish is that people subscribe more to intelligent planning, so that we have a happier and healthier earth. Well, the good news is I've ended my talk.